Here we are, and let's begin. 7 o'clock in the morning here in Chiang Rai, Thailand. And boy, it was pitch black. When I woke up about a quarter to six, it was really looking like nighttime, but it's warming up and it's brightening up now. So I've been developing a discipline called Seishindo for, I don't know, about at least 40 years now. And it's based on my study of Aikido, NLP. Well, those are the two main disciplines. And what I feel like I've discovered over time is that the way a person uses their body and breathes when they're dramatically changes the way they perceive their situation, themselves in the situation. So Barbara has asked to be my client today, and that's good. In these sessions, we're not looking to solve the world's biggest problems or anything like that. What I'm looking to do is what I call kind of first level learning, is help people have a different emotional experience in regard to their challenges. And usually something reasonably clear will come out in the course of a session. So I'm going to work with Barbara, I don't know exactly, maybe about 35, 40 minutes. And then I'm going to allow for 15, 20 minutes to debrief, where everyone will be invited to ask questions and make comments and such. So Barbara, you want to please unmute yourself?
I'm sorry, what?
Yeah, good. Please say hello. There you go.
Hi, everybody. I'm Barbara.
So thank you for being such a brave person.
You're welcome.
And what is it you'd like to work with today, Barbara?
Well, this is, first of all, a wonderful opportunity, so I thank you for for providing it for us. Secondly, it gave me an opportunity to ask a woman that I have been partnering with for the last 3 or 4 years, and we work well together as co-facilitators and designers of workshops and so on. So I told her about this opportunity. I said, what would be one thing that you would suggest I work on? So it was great to get her feedback. She said, well, I know you better, but here's the thing. When I offer an idea to you, you will often, if you have an opinion, just turn to me and say, you have a different idea, or that isn't going to fly, or something, some kind of abrupt and very dismissive kind of response. So for example, she might say, we need another session for our resilience workshop. And you might say, no, we don't. she knows that I am perfectly open to hearing her ideas, but it often takes her aback, and she has to sort of circle around and come back and say, you know, I have this idea, I'd like to talk to you about doing an extra session. And then of course I will say, of course, let's talk about it. But I'm aware that I do this in different circumstances, so it was wonderful that she pointed it out to me. And it used to be more of a problem when I had direct reports, because I would do this to them. They might come to me with an idea and I would say, that's, you know, I would in some way, shape or form say, it's not a good idea, or I don't, you know, not right now, or some other kind of dismissive comment. And in my less self-aware days, I would say to them, well, if you feel like I shut you down, just come back and tell me. But of course that was fine for one or two of them, but most of them would not do that. So it is a little remnant of some old behavior that I have of just sort of shutting somebody down when I'm not interested in that idea at that moment.
Okay.
And so I would like
to stop there, please, if you don't mind. So, because a lot of content. So take a moment, please, Barbara, and come up with an intention for today, what you'd like to accomplish in working with me today.
I'd like to be more thoughtful when people approach me with ideas.
Okay. So let's make believe you've already accomplished that what would be the statement that you would make?
That when people come to me with ideas, I am curious and explore them with them.
Okay, good, good start. So then what I'm gonna ask you to do is to sit up straight and to, that's right, and to not use your hand on your chin and take a deep breath. And then when you're ready, make any kind of comment in regard to, I listen to people and respectful for what of what they say, or however it is that, that you want to word it. Make some further comments about it.
In terms of the result that I'd like to have, is that what you're asking?
And just going ahead and making believe you're already doing it. Please, so, you can tell us how you got there. You can, whatever it is that comes up for you.
So I guess I would say that when...
Okay, and before you go further, excuse me for interrupting you, bring your head down and more like you're looking directly at the video camera, please, and then begin again.
Okay. I guess I would say that I'm more receptive to people's ideas, to at least discussing them and learning why they are thinking the way they are, and it often leads to very productive conversations.
Good. Take a deep breath. And how does that feel to be doing it?
It feels fine. Feels good, like I'm centered and more open.
Okay. So perhaps when you've had the challenge before of not listening, perhaps it just more or less was a function of your not being really present. What do you think about that?
I think that's entirely possible.
Okay. Take another deep breath. And this time I'm going to ask you to center your head a little bit more. You have it dipping towards, I think you're right. Yeah, that's it. Right there. Someone coming on. Tell me how you're feeling now, please.
I feel fine.
Okay. You feel fine. And do you feel like you're a step closer to meeting your challenge, to successfully meeting your challenge?
I guess I would have to say I don't know yet. When I'm in a calm state and not sort of triggered by somebody and, you know, kind of somebody coming at me with an idea, I'm okay, because I think my intent is to listen, but I don't always. So clearly not being fully present is probably a good description. Yes. I feel more fully present in the moment.
And you now. Feel more fully present in the moment now?
Yes.
Yes. And you said, when people come at me with new ideas, it didn't sound like it was a friendly experience.
Well, I would say it's pesky. I would say that I probably react when I think that it is, that it's not something that I am quite ready to consider. And so it feels like kind of intruding a bit. And these are not strong, you know, like you said, we're not solving the problems of the world, but it does feel like I'm not ready to hear it, put it that way.
Okay, take a deep breath. Make your head straighter again. So sounds like one of the things I hear is part of you knows it's extremely helpful to get feedback, and part of you would prefer to not be getting it at this time. How does that fit you?
Are you talking about feedback right now, or are you
when your one of your colleagues comes up with some new ideas?
Oh yeah. So, often I'm okay with that, but if I'm in a hurry or there's something else in my mind, maybe I'm not quite so noticing that I have had an impact on them.
Okay. And what would you do to notice?
Well, that would be my question. I think that just talking about this, just having this conversation is bringing, just asking and my colleague today and then having this opportunity to talk about it is sort of calling up this experience for me. It was not in my mind to work on this tonight, but when I asked my friend Nancy about something, she readily came up with this, so I think that it's something that I should pay more attention to. So this is good just to be talking about it.
Okay, great. So take a deep breath. And the great thing is you're starting with a positive intention, and you're starting with the intention of wanting to be able to listen better, correct?
Yes.
So that's crucial. And then my suggestion is, as you're like, I just adjusted the way I was sitting. If you adjust the way you're sitting so it feels like you're sitting nice and straight, and during the course of talking to your colleague, if you build a habit up of taking some deep breaths. Now I'm taking a breath that's quite noticeable. Maybe you can even hear it. You don't have to necessarily do it like that, but chances are you're racing a little bit too much at times, huh?
That could be.
You know, and when you take the time to slow down and something you can do while you're listening to another person is you can also notice what's in your visual field. And you can feel some sensations in your body, maybe some movement, your feet on the floor, your butt on the chair. Take a deep breath, please. Straighten your head a little bit. That's it. And a little bit more down with the chin. Tell me how you're feeling in regard to this challenge now.
I think when I'm in this kind of state, I'm much more receptive for sure.
Good. That's the idea, right?
Right.
So you can see that your ability to receive and listen really depends on the way you're using your body and your senses. So when you give a little attention to yourself, how you're sitting, how you're breathing, that's right, without the hand on your chin, good for you. And it's funny, sometimes the system seems to know, I don't know how to do it, Tony will maybe teach me later, I could keep you as the main person on the screen the whole time. But sometimes it's like you smiled and the system gave me your picture all of a sudden, like it knew you were smiling.
That's interesting.
So how are you feeling now?
I'm feeling fine. You know, this is a fine way to bring this to my attention.
Yes, and so in my work in general, rather than saying things like, well, maybe you should think like this, maybe you should think like that, and so forth and so on, and sometimes giving people a sense that, ooh, maybe there's something wrong with me, maybe I'm selfish, maybe that you begin to see if you simply change the way you're using yourself. Take a deep breath and do that now, please. You feel quite able to listen and actually inviting good ideas. Is that correct?
Yes, and it's a good reminder. I had a coaching session last night where I think I jumped a bit quickly on my client. Not in a terrible way, but I didn't really need to be jumping the way I did to intervene in something, a role play she was doing. So I think if I had been more attentive and centered, I probably would not have done the same thing.
Yeah, good. So, you know, while having good posture and not going like this, I think it's good to sort of think of yourself as one of these parabola antennas that picks up the TV signals and sends them to the TV set. And if there was a parabola antenna that just you could fold up and then it wasn't going to take any signals, wasn't going to be able to take in any signals, you know, you're also looking at your TV and wondering why nothing's happening. So if you just have a bit of a sense of yourself, like a parabola, or I'm not sure how to pronounce the word, antenna, take a deep breath. And then that can also most likely help you to actually say, so what do you think about this, Sandy? What could we do? Like, I like to think of what could we do more of, what should we perhaps do less of, and what should we keep just the same?
You mean as a response to somebody suggesting something to me?
Well, partially just as a way of thinking. So some people would say I'm too good at critiquing. And so that when they hear my critique, I have a similar situation to you. You know, someone gives me an idea, and rather than saying, oh, that's good, actually, and I can also immediately think of how we could make that better, I just go into, at times, immediately how I think we can make it better. So that the other person will wind up feeling slighted, and then I'm wondering why they're feeling slighted. I consider myself enthusiastic when working with people and being with people. And then sometimes I find myself having to say, I like the idea, I liked it, but I immediately saw how we could make it better. And then so whether it's my colleague or my friend will say, you know what, it'd be really helpful if you tell me first that you like it and then come up with ways that we can make it better.
You know, it's interesting because I try to do that when I write like an email or something. I try to start with a positive comment, no matter whether I'm going to provide different ideas or not like their, whatever it is, I try to start with a positive comment, but I hadn't thought about that in terms of, that would be an action I could take when somebody says, what about this? I could start with something positive, whatever else I have in my mind, in addition to thinking about my, just taking it slower, but
yes,
just keeping in mind that my response, should I need to have one, could just be, that's a really interesting idea, let's talk about it. It's just a different response that I could actually have in my head. This is not complicated stuff, but it's just like, oh, that could be a nice alternative if I could just remember to do that.
Okay, good. So I think you'll be willing to do this or happy to do it even. If not, you just let me know and of course we won't do it. So I'd like to ask you, I'm going to ask you in a moment, not the answer yet. I'm going to ask you, who is Barbara? And then I'd like you to say one or two or maximum three things, slowly. Are you okay with doing this exercise?
Yes.
Okay, who is Barbara?
So I am Barbara, and I'm thoughtful and kind and insightful.
Yes, I can see that. You're thoughtful, kind, and insightful. Good for you. And who else is Barbara, please?
Barbara is also impatient and often too quick to make an assessment about other people and even herself, even myself.
Maybe I'll reframe that one a little bit if you don't mind. Barbara is sometimes impatient. Is it more like that?
Yes, I'm sometimes impatient.
Yes, I can see that, and that's also fine. And let me ask you, who else is Barbara?
So Barbara is also a...
Head straight, please.
It's also a dedicated friend, partner, colleague, and coworker, someone who enjoys working with others and likes the diversity of thought that occurs and the way in which we generate new ideas and new things.
Yeah, I can see all of that. That's good. Take a deep breath. So you look over that whole range of who is Barbara. Some pretty good stuff, huh?
Hard one.
Excuse me?
Hard one. Yes. Hard one appreciation, but yes.
Well, you know, of course, the premier example of I don't get no respect is Rodney Dangerfield.
Right.
And I think to some extent we have to earn respect from people. And when I say earn it, I don't mean like buying them a gift or something, but, you know, showing up on time, listening, being collaborative, being solution oriented. And then people wind up saying, wow, I really like working or being with Barbara.
May I say one thing about that?
Sure.
I don't disagree with solution oriented, but often first comes really understanding an issue and really listening to where somebody's coming from. And as a coach, I don't necessarily try to solve someone else's problems, but help them become more aware, just like you're doing with me.
Yeah, good. And when I say solution-oriented, I don't mean, like I gave you some directions about changing your posture, but I'm not here trying to more or less tell you or any of my other clients, well, Barbara, you really should do X and Y. I'm saying whatever, so solution oriented, I think means we're focusing on a goal or intention.
Uh-huh.
So it's actually interesting. If I say to myself, if I create some kind of like mantra, like I'm a bit too heavy for sure. If I create a mantra that's like, I'm losing weight, I'm losing weight, I'm losing weight, I'm losing weight. On one level, that might seem like, oh, good, that will focus me. But what am I really saying is I'm overweight, I'm overweight, I'm overweight, correct?
You could be. Sure.
Well, why would I want to lose weight if I wasn't overweight? you know, assuming I wasn't bulimic or something, which I certainly am not, if I'm saying to myself, I'm losing weight, it's because I believe I'm overweight. So what I try to show people how to do, for instance, is making believe I've already accomplished my intention and saying, I'm slim and fit and feeling great. And then I take a deep breath. I'm slim and fit and feeling great. And then depending, I might have a voice that comes in my head and says, who are you kidding? Or something like that. And then I can coach myself to understand that time is really all happening at once. And whatever we think in our head, this is my understanding, other people believe this also, your nervous system doesn't know whether you're talking about the past, the present, or the future. Just like when you're dreaming, let's say you almost had an accident in your car today, and you dream about that tonight, you're having very much the same reactions that you had when it actually happened earlier in the day. So your nervous system doesn't know whether you're thinking or dreaming about the past, the present, or the future. It's reacting to your thoughts. And I tend to say one of two things. Either it's your thoughts that lead to your feelings, your emotional state, or I also like to say the opposite of that, which is your emotional state and what you're doing with your body leads to your thinking. So when I'm asked you early on to adjust your posture and not be sitting like this and such, because when your body mind, because all of the whole unit of self has mind, it has intelligence. When you're using yourself gracefully, you'll tend to think more gracefully and or creatively and or more solution oriented. What do you think about that?
I think that's right. I think that other people sometimes say I'm graceful, and I don't know that I always feel that way. But I think that this idea of posture and breathing is helpful.
Yes. And, you know, my friend Stephen Gilligan, he has an exercise that he's been doing for years. And so sometimes when I asked, like when I asked who is Barbara, and for instance, let's just say you said thoughtful, and then Stephen would reply, except when you're not. And then you would say, I'm kind. I'm so kind. And then Stephen would say, except when you're not. And if you said, you're greedy, he would, of course, say, except when I'm not. So I think often when people get upset with us, and I mean, I tend to do this as well, but when people tend to get upset with us, they create an identity that's no longer fluid. And they see you as either X or Y. And when they see us as only X or only Y, then it limits what they're able to notice about us, and it really limits what I can do with that other person.
Yes, I agree with that.
You know, so you came wanting to be more attentive to your clients and friends and colleagues. How are you feeling in that regard now?
Well, like I said, this focus on it is probably a great increased awareness about it. And both the breath and attention and how I'm holding myself, it's all useful. It's all useful.
Good.
I feel like better equipped to probably, even if I'm sort of caught unaware, I feel like it will kind of remind me that I could slow down to take a breath. I could say something positive. There's several things I could do here.
And you're more realizing those several things you can do now, correct?
Yes.
Yeah, good. So have we done a pretty good job in addressing your concern?
Yes, I think so. I mean, I think that the increased awareness is just really helpful. And so, yes.
So, yeah. So I think, you know, if I'm kind of like sitting like this talking to you, you might even wonder, gee, my goodness, what's going on with Charlie? So the more I give some light attention to myself and also to what's going on around me. So I don't sit here like, oh, I just heard somebody outside came to work and I don't disrupt my attention, but at the same time, I'm paying attention. And one of the things you can do is if you learn to watch someone's breathing patterns, like you just breathe there, that's good. I notice that, and that's a nonverbal signal to me that you're feeling pretty good right now. So the more nonverbal signals I can get from you, because the nonverbal signals are pre-verbal, which means we give those signals even when we're trying to be sociable. Like if I'm like waiting for that person to shut up, if they were watching my face, they would know that I'm really not enjoying listening to them.
Right.
So the more you can watch the nonverbal signals, the more you're able to change course before the condition perhaps enlarges a bit.
Yes, and I suppose that if I see that somebody has sort of turned away or shut down a little bit, that I could engage differently right in the moment.
Yes. Yeah, and I think one of the other things, Barbara, is just thinking how the best way to say it is, how can I really have a positively oriented experience or opinion of this other person? Because I think I even need to be careful when I'm saying, oh, Fred's shutting down right now. Fred's just always the name I used to not have to think about it. Fred's shutting down right now. Sometimes it can be too easy for me to think, oh, something's going on with Fred, instead of something's going on with the relationship that I'm having with Fred.
Yes, and I think actually I take a step back from that and have to kind of say, am I really going to care about that right now? I think this is somehow at the core of some of this for me. The bigger picture is caring about my relationship with the person.
Yes.
And in the moment, ignoring something like that is damaging. Even if a tiny pinprick of damage, it's still a negative.
Yes. Well, at least I would say it's not a positive, most likely. And I'm sure you know the terms. There's task and then there's relationship. And
right.
I think what we all find out in life, unless we have really tumultuous relationships with people, the better the relationship, the easier the task gets done.
Yeah.
The worse the relationship, the more difficult or even seemingly impossible the task becomes.
Yes.
Okay, good. So that happens to be about 40 minutes in total. And I think the hallmark of my work, when it's going well, because obviously sometimes it works better than others, is I focus on the person with how they can use themselves more gracefully, more efficiently, more effectively, their body and their breathing. And that will tend to open them up to information, open them up to understanding. And when that happens, instead of kind of butting our heads against, well, I want to do this, but I can't because people open to the field of information that's in them and around them. And it gives the client, another person, actually a chance to tap into me, not me as a special Charlie, but just another human being. So now there's two people actively working on the same challenge. So I think your situation seemed very simple. We could have looked at it from a much more negative viewpoint, and you could have come away thinking, maybe this is worse than I thought, or something like that. We focused on the positive outlook, and very quickly you were saying, basically, got it. Yeah?
Well, what I liked was you took me almost immediately to expressing or declaring what it would be like if I were already doing it.
Yes. Okay, good. Yeah. In NLP, that's called future pacing. And again, the importance of that is, in my mind, is that your nervous system doesn't recognize whether you're talking about the past, the present, or the future. So when an athlete, let's say a basketball player, when they're visualizing making their field goals, they're not trying to, somehow trick themselves into making believe they never miss one. But when they're doing a really good job of visualizing making the field goal, their body does the micromuscular movements that they would be doing when they do make it. And one thing that intrigues me, because I don't follow any particular team, but I like to watch athletes. I like to watch soccer sometimes because there's so many of them are such incredible athletes, is they take a three-point shot, which means they're really far away from the basket. And the really top players, they let go of the ball and they're already turning, running in the other direction because they're 100% certain it's going in. And I think that's something really amazing to be able to do. A little bit I played basketball, it all seems like it happens out of chance or something, you know? So
can I ask you a question?
Yes, ma'am.
If a client has a hard time imagining or declaring what it would be like if they were actually doing it, how do you help them with that?
I'm pausing because each client is special, each relationship we have with each client is special. And one of the things I say in my work is that I'm sitting there believing in my clients before they're believing in themselves sometimes. So I just try to gently nurse them along. And it could be, let's say someone was really overweight, let's say they're 40, 50 pounds overweight. I say, well, just imagine that you've already lost the weight that you wanted to lose. What would you say? And if they have trouble saying, I'm slim and healthy and feeling good. I mean, that's my statement right now. They don't have to say exactly that. Then we know that losing weight isn't the issue. Perhaps it's just for the client to believe in themselves. So I would try to, as I say, nurse them along or gently nudge them along or find out more about what's leading them to not believe in themselves, often it's what they learned as a child. But to make sure, you see, like I do hypnosis and a number of other, I have a number of other skills. And sometimes I jokingly say to myself or to my friends when I'm talking to them who are also coaches or hypnotists, I go, you know, I met another client today that's a better hypnotist than I am. And they chuckle and say, how's that? And I go, because I was finding myself getting annoyed with them. And when I find myself getting it, and they haven't said anything bad about me. Maybe, for instance, they're really whining. Oh, nothing seems to work. And there, I believe at times some people have a defense system of annoying other people they know keeps them at bay. So I'm sitting there, I'm trying to help this person relax. And this person's got me annoyed. I've got myself annoyed listening to the person. They're a better hypnotist than me. So Barbara, let's take some feedback from people and see. Hopefully everyone didn't fall asleep. People that have muted themselves, you need to please unmute yourself. You can ask Barbara questions. You can ask me questions.
Well, this is Dennis. Just like to make a comment that interested in a, researching a woman by the name of Margaret Wheatley, last night, W-H-E-A-T-L-E-Y.
Okay. Famous, yeah. Famous consultant. I believe she's passed away now, yeah?
I don't know. I heard about her many years ago.
Okay.
And I didn't realize she was a management consultant or trainer.
Yes.
In any event, you know, it dawned to me that you know, Barbara reminded me of, you know, the videos and information I had seen on Margaret Wheatley last night, who basically opened my eyes to this whole notion of learning organizations, and Peter Tsang, and this whole idea that, you know, within the group context, you know, there's just a bunch of different moving parts that, you know, kind of work in tandem. So,
okay.
I know Barbara is a consultant and helps people with these things. So I see some synergy between what I stumbled on last night and being on the call with Barbara, and both did a great job. So thank you very much.
Okay. And is there anything that either you found interesting or you're questioning or?
No, I've spoken with you before, Charlie, on some coaching things, and probably like to give it a go. Again, I'd noticed that it worked very smoothly with yourself and Barbara, and I've heard you on calls with others on a coaching, I forget the particular topic, but for some reason, we were a little rough, and it was snowstorms, and I don't know,
yes,
all this crazy stuff.
I remember going on. That. You were up on the roof, I think.
Yeah, they're shoveling off the roof. Yep, you've got it.
Yes. Okay, thanks, Dennis.
You're welcome. Thank
you. Anyone else? I see a friend of mine showed up a bit late. Anyone else like to ask a question, make a comment?
Hi, this is Carrie. I had a question.
Okay.
You were talking about when you described your emotional state and your body language affect your thinking. And you were saying when you see yourself as X or you see yourself as Y, you're no longer fluid. Can you talk about what you meant by you're no longer fluid?
When I find myself, I'll say a couple of things, as I often do, because my mind goes like boom, boom, boom. When I get jet lagged, like I just was recently on a trip truly around the world. And when I'm jet lagged, I'll just say it like this. I'm kind of sitting there. For me, it's an emotional issue. All of a sudden, I feel like my life is horrible. I'm failing tremendously, whatever. And I notice I'm very static and just sitting there. So if I start out like this and I'm going, wow, I feel a little bit unusual today, and I move, I'm not making who I am static. I'm not making the condition I'm in static. And if I can think of the term that we use in NLP, this is the way I use it anyway, called nominalization, is when you take, this is the way I say it, you take a verb and you change it into a noun. Here's the way I would explain it sometimes. If I say my marriage isn't working, makes marriage to me seem like a noun, and I can take that marriage and put it in a box and put it up in the closet or something. But I think in actuality, if I'm married, I'm marriaging all the time, and so is my wife. So if I allow myself to say, I'm in jet lag right now, I don't hear or get the beginning of anything positive happening out of that, and it makes me static and I feel horrible. Have I answered your question or not?
Yeah, that was a good description. Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else?
Yeah, so this is Dennis. You were saying that you move around to get out of the jet lag state?
Yes. To be clear, I'm not saying I go like this a little bit and 5 minutes later I'm feeling fantastic. Yeah. But I'm moving and being fluid, and I can actually say to myself, I'm feeling great, I'm feeling really energized, and life is fantastic. And yeah, there'll be a part of me that says, who the hell are you kidding? But I keep on doing some movement, or something that I do regularly, really related to NLP, is I'll roll my eyes around in circles two or three times in one direction, two or three times in another direction, because scientific research apparently tells us that 95% of all of our internal dialogue we're not conscious of. Like, I didn't hear. Did I really just say that to myself? I did, but I don't know it. My opinion on top of that is that, and this is just my opinion, I have no proof to show this, I think that 95% of all our visual imaging is also outside of our conscious mind. We're flashing pictures. If you've ever seen one of these kind of tests or something that says, okay, watch this, what did you just see? And you say, I didn't see anything. And then they'll ask you a series of questions that lead you to understand that you did actually see a lion. You know, where they'll go like, what did you see? Nothing. How are you feeling right now? Oh, frankly, a little frightened. Oh, why is that? Turns out on some level, I did see the lion. So I think when I'm saying I'm jet lagged or I'm not good enough or whatever the negative assessment of myself is, I'm most likely seeing myself in some context. And when I do this with my eyes, to me, it resets my visual machinery.
So you're saying you do that with all states, not just jet lag, but if you're feeling down, having a bad hair day or whatever,
yes.
You can.
Yes, and these, again, Dennis, to be clear, these are helpful things to do for sure. But I'm not saying do your eyes like this and move around like this and 10 minutes later, no matter what condition you were in, you'll feel like everything's great, but it'll put you on the right path.
It's a start. Got it.
Yes. Okay. Thanks. Anyone else, please? Going once.
Yeah, I had a question for Barbara. I just written a number of notes, I forget. Oh, just I guess more of a comment. She was, and I think you both mentioned the busy mind concept, that just in summary, major takeaway was what you were going through, Charlie, was a simple version to get present and calm the mind down, which affects us all going through things on a daily basis. So it.
Yes. Well, you know, Dennis, in this work, this entire unit of self has mind.
Yeah.
So it's been proven now a number of years ago that at least 95%, if not 100%, I don't know where the research has gotten in the last couple of years, 95 to 100% of all of the serotonin in the body is produced in the gut without mediation from the brain in your skull. And what are all of the antidepressive medications and stuff about? They're what's called serotonin uptake.
Some type of blockers,
reuptake inhibitors.
Yes.
So this whole unit is your mind.
Yeah.
And the more we think about ourselves like that, I think the better off we wind up doing in the world.
So the whole body is the mind, not just the squash?
The entire unit is intelligent.
Yeah.
And the entire unit has responsibility for activating certain processes and stuff. And I hesitate to say the whole unit thinks, because perhaps thinking is just something that the cognitive mind does. You know, that one it's thing.
Like guts attached to the mind, and it all works together.
We have a cognitive mind.
Yes.
It's all attached to the cognitive mind, and things wind up working better.
Okay.
Anyone else?
So I love what you just said about the brain thinks, but the whole unit is intelligent. It's like the whole unit is minding you.
Yes. I mean, like I often suggest to people that they have a thankfulness routine.
Mm-hmm.
And when I do a thankfulness routine, I also say things like, and thank you, God, for that big contract that I didn't get at the last moment. And thank you for that girlfriend that told me to get lost. And all of the positive things, because there's an intelligence in all of it. And once we start recognizing that, I think that we don't take each and every, at first, seemingly negative event as necessarily negative. So the idea is you learn a hell of a lot more from losing than you do from winning. The only problem with that is losing usually feels like shit. But you learn much more. Yep. So, my mom died at 90 years old. And when people ask me, you know, what did she die from? I just say old age. But in actuality, she wound up with brain cancer. And the wonderful thing, if you can say that, about brain cancer is the brain does not have, this is what the doctor told me, so I'm assuming it's true. The brain doesn't have pain receptors. So he said, your mother will not be in any pain at all until maybe 24 to 48 hours before dying, because the brain will be enlarging the tumors, and at some point she won't be able to breathe properly and such. But he said, the brain has absolutely no pain receptors. So, whenever any of us find ourselves saying something like, I'm depressed, I'm angry, I'm exhilarated, your brain is reporting on what the rest of the unit is experiencing. But the brain literally does not feel. So important to keep that in mind.
So it seems important to change the feeling to somehow feel better and keep you feeling better.
So usually if you ask people, how do you know you're depressed? for instance, they don't really know the answer to that. I just feel like junk. But what's going on in your body? They have no idea. The more they can tune into what's going on in their body, the more they'll understand this label that they've been using called depression. And once again, I would say that depression is a nominalization. It's a verb that's been turned into a noun.
Okay. So, Charlie, I wanted to acknowledge Matt Minahan put in the chat that he actually has a question, and I'm not sure if he's on audio or not.
Oh. Allowed to talk. Oh, I see. Question and answer. Of course, Matt Minahan. Please.
Charlie, hi. And Carrie, hi. And Deb, hi. And Barbara, thanks for being our case tonight. This is way cool. So, Charlie, I just want to see if I can put all the pieces together here.
Okay, go ahead.
So a person is stuck. Something's not working. They're not feeling successful at something. And coaching, the somatic coaching approach here, the Seishindo coaching approach, is to help them reorganize something, help them reorganize the way they think. And you're using the body to do that. So you're changing the breathing pattern and changing the speaking rhythm and changing the physical attributes of the head and changing kind of their posture. Am I right that changing those kind of biological items helps to change the make fluid, I think your word is fluid, make fluid their thinking about themselves?
Yes, exactly, Matt. I think what I say is, and I say these things more aesthetically, but rather than, okay, let's argue about this if we don't agree, is that your body has a language that's at least as sophisticated, complex, and complete as your verbal language.
Okay.
And in fact, this language of your body, and I don't mean body language in the way that, you know, oh, I've crossed my hands in front of my chest, that means I'm unreceptive, but this language of your body is what leads to the language of your cognitive mind, which is your verbal language.
Okay, so you're basically using reorganizing the body as an entree to reorganizing the thinking?
Yes. And when you reorganize the way, I would say, the way the body's being used,
mm-hmm.
get the person to be a bit more fluid. That's what I call, I said initially with Barbara, that's what I call learning level number one, which is I start to notice that the client becomes a bit more positive and or solution oriented, even though perhaps they don't yet fully agree or fully believe that they can lose weight or, you know, be mm-hmm. more successful.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, that's very helpful, Charlie. Thank you.
Okay, great. And thanks for showing up, Matt. And Carrie, thanks for mentioning that, because the question and the answer button is way at the bottom of my screen, and I'll have to remember to pay attention to that again. But I wasn't watching that at all, so it was good that you were watching it.
Yeah, I have a quick question, Charlie. This is Dennis. What has been very interesting tonight. I wonder what the next step, are there going to be future events like this? Or
there will hopefully, as long as people start continue to show up, there'll be other events like this. And what I've decided to do is do a coaching session like this with one person each webinar, and then I little thinking and weave it all together.
Okay.
And so I would say, if you've enjoyed this tonight, please, in whatever social networks you're active in, please make a comment or something, and because keeping an active audience takes a bit of work. And the easiest way for it to happen for me is that when some of you all say to your colleagues, wow, I found that interesting, hopefully you did, and or the next time I make an announcement, you can pass it on to some of your networks, that would really help.
Yeah, happy okay. to do that.
So, thank you for this evening.
Thank you.
And kapun makrap in Thai language.
What's the best way to contact you about
my coaching? Email is always, and I'm sure you got it, Dennis.
Okay.
Okay, folks.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Charlie-san.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.